two, one.
You'll never have the sacred stone.
Oh, this, you crazy mother.
You're listening to the Big and Tall Sports Show with your host Pete Apostolopoulos and Alec Reid.
What is going on, everybody? Welcome to the Big and Tall Radio Show. Alec and Pete with you as always. Episode number 12, a bit of a painful athlete we're naming it after today. Alec, you want to take this one?
I hate this because I am very anti-Tom Brady, but it's so perfect that episode number 12, in honor of the GOAT, the greatest of all time, Tom Brady, Thomas Brady. With the greatest Super Bowl performance of all time, agree or disagree?
It's up there.
It's up there.
I mean, Steve Young, 6 TDs, probably.
Yeah, but no comeback, right? That comeback is the stuff of legends. We can discuss that later, but I want to get into the show because we got a great lineup. Obviously, talking some Super Bowl and a couple of other things we got lined up. World Baseball Classic, Team Canada roster was announced. I know Pete wants to talk about that. But make sure you're tweeting at us. Tweet at us your questions at Big and Tall Sport. Follow us on Twitter, Alec Reid, at Alec Reid 14.
At Big Pete 44.
So make sure you follow us there. We're going to take your questions in the second half of the show. And we're also going to take your answer to Alec's ridiculously in-depth trivia question of the day.
I already got this right.
Pete already got it right. He's not going to say his answer then.
First shot. No,
he's not going to say his answer. So every week I do a ridiculously in-depth trivia question, which I like to think that they're pretty good. I've had a few good ones the past couple of weeks.
I've got everyone right.
No, you didn't get
for
no.
The one. Sorry, I got last week's.
There
one.
You go. Okay, so my ridiculously in-depth trivia question of the day. According to ESPN, only one team had less bets on them to win the Super Bowl this season going into the preseason. Than the Falcons. So one team had less bets placed on them to win the Super Bowl at the start of the season.
I thought you were going to do the other one.
No. We're doing this one.
Okay, well, I got both right. So
which team was it? Which team had less bets on them winning the Super Bowl, according to ESPN, at the start of the season to win it all? So less bets than the Falcons. They were second worst, if you can believe that.
Was it? No, it wasn't odds. It was the bets.
It was the
amount
bets.
Of
the
bets
amount of
placed
bets
on
placed.
That team.
Not the actual odds, because I think we all know Cleveland probably had the lowest odds. Maybe they had the lowest bets.
This team was pretty.
Who knows? So tweet at us. Tweet us your answers at Big and Tall Sport. Pete, first segment of the day. What do we got lined up?
We have our athlete of the week or our player of the week presented by My Quetzal.
I'll show off the phone. Phone cases. Right here.
Yeah. So I think that we both kind of agreed on this one pretty unanimously, but we're going to go with Uncle Tommy, Tom Brady. Again, we're both not Patriot fans, so I think by NFL fan rules, you can't like him. But you can respect him.
You can. You have to respect
him. You have to respect him. 43 for 62. They threw the ball 62 times, which I knew that they were going to throw the ball a lot, but you noticed a shift in how that offense was going to work.
Once
LeGarrette Blunt fumbled that ball, he was irrelevant the rest of the game.
Yeah, but Belichick was completely done with him at that point.
Well, that torched a lot of people's props bets.
It did. I want to quickly ask you, Pete, since we got to...
Can I finish the stat line?
All right, go ahead. Finish the stat line.
Brady, 43 for 62, 466, two touchdowns, big comeback. Filmed the commercial with five rings.
Yeah, that was bold.
Before power move of all time. I hate to admit it, that to give that to Tom Brady, but that's the ultimate power move, is filming the commercial, saying you won the game before the game.
And then saying Roger that after.
Big fan of that.
So Alex Zegas tweeted at us.
Zegas.
Besides Brady, who do you got for number two and number three MVP? So maybe who are our runners-up for the Mike Quetzal King of the Castle this week?
So, maybe he's talking about the game.
Well, for the game. I mean, he is one of our runners-up this week.
Okay, so we both said that if Atlanta won, Matt Ryan's probably the MVP. 17 for 23, 284, two touchdowns. I don't really want to blame this on Matt Ryan, and I know he's taken a lot of crap, but I don't think that this is his fault. I think that
It isn't his fault at all, because he played the system that they had put in place absolutely perfectly. I think that, and I've mentioned this a few times, if they run the ball on second and third down with about 3.5 minutes to go, they win that game. Instead, they drop back to pass. He gets sacked. The fumble's not on him. You know, maybe he gets the ball a little earlier. I saw a picture of Julio Jones just came out of a break and was open. But when you look at his stat line and you look at his QBR, I think it was like 141.
I didn't look it up, but I would put money that I don't think another quarterback that has thrown five incompletions didn't win the game.
He had the best QBR for a quarterback that lost in the Super Bowl. So for me, I think it's he would have been the MVP if Atlanta won that game.
And, you know, or him, Devontae Freeman, if they handed him the ball like they should have.
Or I was going to say the defensive back who had the pick six. I can't remember the name. His name. I will.
You were in charge of looking that up.
I literally just had his name in my head, and I just forgot it.
But yeah, the other guy, obviously, who had a big week on a struggling Leafs team, William Nylander had a big week. He had 4 goals last week. Also had his first career hat trick. You know, it kind of seems like these young guys. And again, we had an interview that we did with Leafs blogger and Sportsnet writer Steve Dangle that we're going to tease a little bit later, and you can see the full thing on the website probably tomorrow.
It's going to be up tomorrow. Make sure you tune in. Make sure you stick around, though. Have a little fun teaser for you.
Yeah. So we had an interview with Steve, and we discussed about these young guys, and, you know, it seems like everybody's kind of just – there's so many young, talented players on the Leafs that if one guy's not going well, two other guys are, or vice versa. So – William Nylander has been the guy that's kind of been doing it along with Marner the last week or so, and he had his first career hat trick, so we're going to give him a nominee.
It was Robert Alford who was the guy we were looking for. And if you watch, Robert Alford actually played a very, very good game.
So did Malcolm Butler.
So did Malcolm Butler, other than the one time he got
Sanu
roasted.
That was great.
So if you haven't seen that.
Sanu is irrelevant, though, because of Malcolm
Butler. Oh, absolutely. Robert Alford actually played a really, really good game, and for those defensive buffs out there that love watching defensive players and defensive coaches, I mean, you know, they love watching DBs. Robert Alford, I think, was pretty much the only good player for that second half against the Patriots. So
okay, moving on. Jester of the week, and again, we both were cheering for Atlanta. We both have ties to people who are heavily invested with the Atlanta Falcons, so we were both pulling for them. But I think Jester of the Week is Arthur Blank going down on the sideline from the second half.
It's not even just the fact that he was going down. It's the fact that the camera kept going to him, and he, like, you just saw the devastation on his face just continuously eat at him because he saw the inevitable.
I saw a tweet from Mark Cuban today that I never had thought about this before. Like, I'd thought about it, but I'd never heard anybody put it this way. But he tweeted out, if you run into or meet any Atlanta Falcons players or personnel, you know, don't like talk shit to them, because losing and the pain of losing is a lot worse than the joy, or is a lot.
It's terrible for anyone who's been there. I mean, we're both sports guys, so anybody who's been there and experienced that agony of defeat in a big game. You know, especially the last game of the year. I've been there. I've lost an Ontario championship last game of the year. And you experience that defeat and that agony, and you don't want to talk to anybody, let alone, you know, we can say what we want about Cam Newton last year and how he really didn't want to talk to anybody. I get that feeling. You don't want to talk to anybody, especially if you're the Falcons blowing a 28-3 lead. That's tough, because I couldn't imagine being in that situation, let alone on the grandest stage of them all. I couldn't imagine blowing a 28-3 lead. Let's just put that out there. But I can't imagine on the grandest stage of them all having to face the music after doing all of that.
Yeah, I totally agree. We already talked about Cam Newton. That's kind of...
I just had to bring it up.
But no, rather than me screw it up royally and go verbatim on the Mark Cuban tweet, the tweet was, if you see Arthur Blank or any Falcons player, thank them for a great year. The pain of losing is far greater than the joy of winning. And that's something that, as an athlete, you know, and you understand that fully. But it was interesting to me to read that, because I'd never really heard somebody like Mark Cuban actually say it and put it out there. And I really like that, and I think that that's a great point. And like we just talked about with Matt Ryan, he's going to take a ton of criticism, blame for this, along with Kyle Shanahan, who's
and Dan Quinn as well,
and Dan Quinn. But at the end of the day, like, these guys were the best offense in the league, and really, for three quarters, they were the best team in the game.
As much credit has to go to Bill Belichick and Tom Brady as it does to the Falcons blowing it. You know, we talk about
absolutely.
The Falcons blew a 28-3 lead. Oh, the Warriors blew a 3-1 lead. The Indians blew a 3-1 lead. Nobody talks about how good these teams actually were. You know, Tom Brady and Bill Belichick, and to an extent, Julian Edelman, and you have Chris Hogan. You have White, which we'll get into in a second. But these guys are as much a cog in this comeback as the Falcons are blowing it. Right, but we're all going to talk about, oh, the Falcons blew it. Right, oh, the Warriors blew it. Nobody's going to say, oh, LeBron James engineered a great comeback. No, the Warriors just blew it.
Don't forget too, that New England defense made some big plays to keep that momentum on their side of the field in the end of the third quarter and in the fourth quarter. Again, like we talked about, Malcolm Butler and McCourty shut down the passing game a lot. Julio only had 87 yards. And on that one drive,
He had to make some spectacular catches to get to 87 yards.
If Atlanta wins the game, Julio Jones's catch along the sideline probably gets put in that category with
Tyree. It's being talked
Tyree.
About like Edelman's catch is right now.
Exactly. And I think that catch that Julio Jones made was... Aside from maybe Odell Beckham when he caught it with one hand in the back of the end zone the first time he did it on Sunday Night Football,
yeah.
That might have been the best catch I've ever watched live happen. Like I
would put Santonio Holmes up there as well.
Yeah,
Santonio Holmes, throw on the magnitude of the situation,
yeah.
And I think Santonio Holmes is up there as well.
Yeah,
but I talked about how in a blog post how Julian Edelman's catch was the greatest catch in Super Bowl history. And that's a bold statement considering that Julio Jones might have had the greatest catch in Super Bowl history, but it didn't mean anything because they didn't run the ball.
Yeah.
So it's a tough situation, but, you know, it is what it is. Patriots are world champs, and Arthur Blank and the entire Falcons organization, maybe next year.
Hey, Cleveland Browns tied for first overall in the NFL.
There you go. Undefeated right now.
Everyone's undefeated.
So we're going to move on to the KDOT Fitness Big Man of the Week. If you haven't checked out Kofi, my friend, on YouTube, look him up at KDOT Fitness on Instagram as well and on YouTube. The guy's massive.
Big dude.
So we brought in the Big Man of the Week. This week it goes to a lot of soccer fans out there maybe listening in. Romelu Lukaku plays for Everton in the Premier League. He's 6'2", 204 pounds of just absolute man. The guy's massive.
Belgian national team as well.
Yes. This week scored 4 goals in a 6-3 game versus Bournemouth in the Premier League. 6-3 in like Premier League soccer. That's wild.
It definitely took the over in that game.
Yeah, you had to. But Romelu Lukaku, 4 goals in one game, kind of gets overshadowed due to the fact that he plays for Everton and not a big team.
The guy who leads the league scores like 20, 25, and he scored 4 in one game.
Well, he's leading the league now.
Is he actually?
He is, yeah. Oh, yeah, I think he scored 16 all year.
Yeah,
and he scored four in one game. Yeah, so Romelu Lukaku, absolute beast of a man, scored 4 goals against Bournemouth. He gets our KDOT Fitness Big Man of the Week. So now, Pete, this is your bread and butter section, the one that you came up with.
My guy.
This is Pete's one, and we... We were going to debate about this for a little bit.
So I'll start with the nominee first because it happened yesterday. Curtis McElhinney, 39 saves on 40 shots versus Dallas, played really well. The Leafs really needed a win yesterday, and he played extremely well. And now they're talking about he might start again on Thursday. It's a whole thing. Freddie Anderson hasn't been playing great over the last month or so. Again, we talked about that with Steve.
Yep. Be sure to check it out.
So Curtis McElhinney... as our nominee, but I think the winner is undoubtedly James White, New England, 14 catches, 110 yards, a touchdown. This guy he's a running back, and he had 10 catches,
yeah.
First of all.
14
strike
catches.
Sorry, 14 catches.
For 110 yards.
There it is. He averaged 34 yards receiving per game this year, and he had 60 catches in 16 games and had 14 catches in the Super Bowl. So he pretty much had what he got in a third of a season.
And he won them the Super Bowl.
Yeah, and he won them the Super Bowl.
So
definitely, I don't know, again, this kind of goes back to like we use Chris Hogan as a backup.
He's,
but I think James White is more of a backup than Chris Hogan.
I think.
Well, he's a third string running back.
Well, when you consider the Patriots offensive schemes, I don't think anyone really is a backup. but comparatively speaking, James White is not as big of a role in the grand scheme of the I guess Patriots offensive mastermind that you know that is Tom Brady and his offense loves to spread the ball around, but James White was never that guy. We saw Chris Hogan get it. We saw LeGarrette Blount obviously chew up some yards earlier in the year. Julian Edelman seems to fall in that. Michael Floyd, even one week when he came in. These guys seem to get the brunt of it, and James White, obviously in the biggest game of the year, finally was the recipient of the ball in and the Bill Belichick offensive scheme.
Really? If he was the MVP over, you knew they were going to give it to Brady.
It had to
but
be
Brady. But if they named him the MVP as in an all-time shocker for people, I don't think people would have been that
shocked. Brady even said that James White should have been the MVP.
Yeah. So backup performer of the week, James White.
I want to move on to the Don't Be That Guy of the Week. And we had this one on lock. We had this one down pat for the entire day.
Until
10 minutes ago when this happened. And we'll get the video stream up when we post this on YouTube. I'll get the video of this.
And Alec will retweet the Sportsnet.
That you tweeted out. So if you're looking, I'm gonna go quickly onto Twitter here.
So basically, Minnesota and Chicago Blackhawks are playing tonight. Minnesota Wild, Chicago Blackhawks, NHL. And in the second period, there was a goal scored by Minnesota, and they called it a goal, but they said they were gonna review it. So looking at the review, and NBC at first, who's doing the broadcast, said that, you know, like, he was onside, whatever, blah, blah, blah. Pierre Maguire and Doc Emmert were talking about it like it was a non-issue, it was a formality.
And then you go to the other camera angle.
They changed the angle, and you clearly see Zach Parise is offside by a lot. Like, very noticeable, evident.
It's noticeable when you slow it down and go frame by frame. It's, like, definitively noticeable.
So they're reviewing this. They show the replay in the stadium, and it's in Chicago. Is it in Chicago?
It was in Minnesota. It was in Minnesota.
So it's in Minnesota. So the stadium kind of reacts to it. You can hear it in the background as the announcers are talking over it. And so pretty conclusive that he was offside and it's not going to be a goal. And sure enough, the referee signals it's inconclusive and scores it at a goal. Now,
which if I just retweeted it at Big and Tall Sport, you can find it. It's on Sportsnet. This is atrocious.
Yeah.
Because, I get you missing the call. The ref wasn't in a great spot to make the call, and it's a bang-bang play. Like, mistakes happen. But that's why we have video replay. It's
literally the whole
that.
Point.
It's like, and you slow it down frame by frame. You see, it's not like it's one of those where, it's almost over the line. No, there's a good 2 inches. 2 inches of ice in between Parisi's skate and in between the puck and the blue line. Like, it's so clear that the fact that they missed this is just, it's unbelievable that we have video replay and yet this kind of crap occurs. So referees in the Chicago and Minnesota game that's going on right now, don't be that guy. Also, shout out Joel Quenneville's face after the ruling went down.
Yeah,
he was not happy. Especially because it's a very significant play. Like, that's offside. That's a whistle, and we bring it back.
And it's also getting to the point now where, you know, we're starting to get to the trade deadline, and there are two teams that are in the same division. You know, it's a big game when those two teams play, especially how well Minnesota's played this year, and Chicago's always there. But, you know, we're starting to, the calendar's February now, right?
Yeah.
We're starting to get into crunch time here, and, you know, for replay to be used and for that play to still be called onside is ridiculous.
It's
and
terrible.
Shouldn't happen.
It's terrible. So make sure you still tweet out us your questions at Big and Tall Sport. We want all the questions that we can get. We're going to talk Super Bowl and World Baseball Classic in the second half of the show. So make sure that you tweet out us your questions, and we will get to them. But a couple more segments here. We're going to go to our outrageous predictions for the week. And mine's very outrageous, so I guess I'll start. My outrageous prediction for the week is that Kevin Durant making his return to OKC, a few days? I believe it's Thursday. So tomorrow, I guess, he's making his return. That they are going to cheer him.
No chance.
That is my outrageous prediction.
No chance.
The OKC fans will cheer him. They love him. All the things
no
he did
chance.
For them, all the things he did for them, they're going to cheer him.
No chance.
It is my outrageous prediction for the week. If you think it's that outrageous, then tweet at me, at AlecReid14, and tell me how outrageous it is.
That's not outrageous. That's ludicrous.
It's out there. It could happen.
No chance.
It could happen.
Okay. I would put more predictability odds that Russell Westbrook shakes Kevin Durant's hand during the pregame or after the game than the fans actually cheering for Kevin Durant at any point during the game.
I would put that up there as well, but I'm saying this could happen.
I still think Russell Westbrook giving him a high five is more likely than the fans cheering for him.
I think it is more likely, but I'm saying this is my outrageous prediction, and it could happen.
That's ridiculous.
It's outrageous.
So,
what's your outrageous prediction for the
week? My outrageous prediction of the week? I guess mine's kind of outrageous, too. I think that the Las Vegas Golden Knights will make a trade on trade deadline day, March 1st. So basically, zero assets to trade. So basically, the deal with Vegas now is that all they have to do is sign that last check and cross the T's and dot the I's, and they're an NHL franchise. If they do so before the set deadline, which was March 1st, they're free game. If you're a team like Pittsburgh or a team like Tampa Bay or Chicago or St. Louis or any team with a big stacked lineup that you need to protect guys in ways that the format of the entry or of the expansion draft doesn't let you, you know, if you want to send the Vegas Golden Knights a compensation pick or two to keep them from taking a certain player, that's totally fair game. We've seen it happen when San Jose entered the league. I believe they made 3 trades at the trade deadline that year. So I think Vegas, because there are a lot of teams that could be in some trouble of losing some big assets in the expansion draft if they don't protect them the way that they need to. And the way that the system is set up, certain teams aren't going to be able, whether they pick one of the options or the other one, aren't going to be able to protect all the guys that they want to. So I think Vegas is going to make a trade, and
it's not that outrageous. Like, when you go through the scenario, it's I think without the assets and kind of considering that you said the I's and T's aren't even dotted yet. I think that I think it might happen. I still think no. I think they let it happen.
I think if they get the deal done and it's like a done deal, like Vegas is a team, I think it'll definitely happen, but I think there's more uncertainty of that happening before the deadline than there is of a trade actually happening.
That's fair. So I want to move on. We got one last segment here, and then keep tweeting at us. We're going to get your tweets. We have a bunch of tweets in for the second half of the show, but I want to just quickly remind you guys about my ridiculously in-depth trivia question of the day. According to ESPN, only one team had less bets placed on them than the Atlanta Falcons to win the Super Bowl this year. Which team was it? Tweet at us. Nobody's tweeted at me and got it right yet, so send us your tweets. I'll give you a shout-out if you get it right.
A couple more questions just came in, and I'm really looking forward to
it. I'm very much looking forward to the second half. This is going to be fun. But last segment, matchup of the week, Pete. Who you got?
I'm so excited for this. Tomorrow night, North Carolina at Duke basketball. Coach K, Roy Williams. This is the classic matchup. This is it. Like, I'm a big college basketball guy. I'm not a big NBA guy per se, but this is like the one that you get up for and you watch. No matter who you are, no matter what team you cheer for, you're going to be watching this game. You're going to see if Grayson Allen's going to be tripping guys up on the sideline and causing trouble. Coach K came back on Saturday from his leave of absence from surgery or whatever he was doing. But yeah, Duke, North Carolina, always a good one. They're playing Thursday at Duke, so that should definitely be a must-watch this week.
My must-watch is a little different.
This is a good one.
This is a very good one,
though. This is a good one.
Next Wednesday, we're a week today. I believe it's a 2 p.m. start time. Arsenal versus Bayern Munich in the Champions League. This is a big game. I think both teams are top of their tables. This is an absolutely huge game, especially for Arsenal, who have known for the past decade, being choke artists, especially in the Champions League. Let's see how they do against Bayern. My money's on Bayern. I'm a huge fan of the Bayern system that they have. I don't think that Olivier Giroud against Manuel Neuer, you know, Jerome Boateng, David Alaba, that list is just, I don't think it's going to work.
Shout out.
Big matchup, though. Big matchup to watch. Alexis Sanchez versus Philip Lahm. Rumors that Philip Lahm
retired.
Yeah. So
he's retiring at the end of the season.
So
I don't even know if he's playing. I'm assuming he's
I would assume playing. He's playing in the Champions League.
I know he's retiring.
I heard rumors of it yesterday. Is it confirmed now that he announced it?
He's confirmed
that he's retiring at the end of the year? Because I heard rumors of it, and people were talking about how imagine being the guy to step into Philip Lahm's shoes. He retired from international competition, I guess, over the summer.
No, he retired. He's like
he's fully done.
Yeah,
now?
He's done.
Really?
Yeah. I was gonna say shout out Philip Lahm.
Yeah, but there goes my matchup. I heard he was gonna retire at the end of the year. I guess he's just done.
From his Twitter account, from what's going on here, it looks like he's done.
Wow.
Maybe one of my soccer buddies listening can
probably
weigh in on this.
Yeah, if anyone's heard, tweet at us at Big and Tall Sport whether Philip Lahm is actually done or not.
He posted like a retirement letter in English and in German on his Twitter account.
That's devastating. He's one of the all-time greats, especially for Germany.
Yeah.
So
he's been the captain of Germany for 11 years or something like that.
Yeah, especially with Bastian Schweinsteiger. It's a hard name to say really quick. With him retiring from international competition, that's tough for them.
Yeah, I'm sure they'll be all right.
Yeah, they'll be
defending World Cup champions.
Yeah,
sure,
whatever. They're fine.
They'll be fine.
Anyways, we're gonna head into break. Make sure you tweet at us with your answers to the question: who had less bets on them for the Super Bowl to win this year than the Atlanta Falcons? We're gonna take a quick break. We're gonna leave off here with a little tidbit, a little teaser from our interview with Steve Dangle, and then a couple of ads, and we'll be right back.
Man, they really got to pick up their socks. They got to, I mean, has a team in the NHL had more leads than the Toronto Maple Leafs? Like, even ahead of Washington or Pittsburgh? It has to be the Leafs. But they keep giving them up.
They're almost the reverse of the Toronto Raptors, who we see come back night in and night out.
Yeah, seriously, you know what it reminds me of? Because I used to really be into wrestling. And Booker T.
Booker T, yes.
Used to always say, five times champion. And then I don't remember who it was, but they pick up the mic and went, wow, I can't believe you lost the title five times. And it's true, they keep getting the title and handing it right back. I don't want the Leafs to end up like Booker T. I want them to hold on to the damn thing. Go on a bit of a run. Be CM Punk.
Yeah, CM Punk. Yeah, and then once you finally get the title, you run off the company and sue them afterwards.
Yes,
so
and then get beat up.
And then
get destroyed by
an actual fighter.
Yeah, got a guy in the middle card. Yeah, you see what I'm saying, right?
I see exactly what you're saying.
So, I mean, as long as they keep getting the lead, they just got to focus on losing it, or not losing it.
Do you think that, obviously, like, because they're so young, do you think that as they mature as a team in the next coming years, do you think that we'll kind of see that, you know, look out for the third period, we all think that they're going to blow the lead. Do you think we'll see that kind of change?
Well, I mean, Roman Polak and Matt Hunwick aren't getting ID'd at the bar. Like, this isn't, and neither is Jake Gardner anymore. You know, maybe sometimes with the LCBO because of that 25 and under rule, but... Like, I mean, they're not as young as people give off. And even Nikita Zaitsev, that's a guy in his mid-20s too. But there's going to be a learning curve with him because he's coming from the KHL. Connor Carrick is legitimately young. We forget, but Morgan Riley is legitimately young. A good way to get good at something is to fail at it a bunch of times. Take it from me. So I wonder if this doesn't help the Leafs out in the long run. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
You'll never have the sacred stone.
Oh, this you crazy mother.
Tired of dropping your phone? Then look no further than the My Quetzal Smart Case Handler. The My Quetzal Smart Case Handler is a brand new smartphone accessory that will fulfill your need to secure your phone in your hand, all while eliminating the risk of dropping it. To find out how this new innovative product accomplishes this, visit athandsmartcase.com. That's A-T-H-A-N-D smartcase.com. Available for most smartphone styles at an affordable cost. It's my Quetzal at athandsmartcase.com. Once again, that's A-T-H-A-N-D smartcase.com.
This is Kofi Two Sugars from K-Dot Fitness. If you guys are looking for tips, tricks, you want to lift heavy, or you want to lose some weight, or you want to step on stage and get some free advice, take a look at my Instagram at Kofi and Two Sugars, or you can go on YouTube at KDOT Fitness.
And we're back on the Big and Tall Sports Radio Show. Welcome back. If you want to see the full interview with the one and only Steve Dangle, be sure to go check him out. Be sure to check it out tomorrow. It's going to be up on our YouTube page. We're going to post a full 25-minute interview. We had a great interview, great talk with Steve Dangle. He's a great guy.
Great dude.
So be sure to check that out. We're going to have that up tomorrow. We're going to get to your questions here on Twitter.
Really quick, shout out David Ellis for... letting me know right as I found it, Philip Lahm retiring at the end of the season. So he is playing.
There we go. Alexis Sanchez versus Philip Lahm. Check that matchup out. It's going to be huge. So I want to start with a question from the actual voice of the intro of the Big and Tall Sports Show, Briar, at Your Briar Desire. Great Twitter handle. Pete, why don't we show the folks at home? Pete, why don't you stand up here? Briar wants to know, hey, Pete, why are you wearing camo pants today? Trying to hide that you're a Leafs fan?
So
check out the camo pants.
Yeah, camo pants.
Beautiful. So I'm going to move my head.
We found them in the closet at the condo, and I threw them on and said, I'm going to wear these to school. And then they kind of sat there for a couple months. And then yesterday I was doing my laundry, and I decided, you know what? I'm going to wear the camo pants.
They look gorgeous.
I
love your Instagram picture. Go check it out, at
LaPistola44. La Pistola 44. Yeah,
great,
you know,
Instagram
what?
Picture.
You just gotta wear, literally and figuratively, just wearing it.
Just wear it.
I they're really comfortable. They're really warm. Like they're hunting. They're meant for hunting. So, I mean, camo pants.
It's great. I love it.
Just if you know me, then it's like it doesn't surprise you.
No, not at all. So we're gonna get into your questions, but first, the Alex ridiculously in-depth trivia question of the day. Pete actually did get this right. Again, nobody getting it right on Twitter.
I needed one help question.
He did get one help question. I gave him the conference. So
AFC team.
If I told you guys AFC South, that would narrow it down to two teams.
You could pick any of them. Teams.
Maybe not Houston. A lot of Houston fans out there. Well, a lot of Houston fans that bet, right?
Well, no. Well, they had the best defense in the league.
It's true. That's true.
Like, Maybe.
I'm
and
still
Brock
not...
Osweiler. This was before the season. This was like Brock Osweiler was supposed to be good.
Yeah. So Alex, ridiculously in-depth trivia question of the day. Only one team had less bets to win on them than the Falcons. Which team was it, Pete?
The Tennessee Titans.
Tennessee Titans.
Which surprised me because I really like Marcus Mariota. But I said to Alec, I was like, it's either going to be Jacksonville or Tennessee. But then I narrowed it down to Tennessee because I said Jacksonville was decent at the end of last year. And a lot of people loved Blake Bortles with the two big wide receivers. And, you know, they brought in a lot of new players from free agency and everyone was all on Jacksonville. They're going to go 8-8 this year. Yeah.
Yeah, no. Shout out Jeff Fisher, 8-8 squad. Oh, he didn't even get
not
there.
Not even 8-8. Blake Bortles was not very good.
He's
this
garbage.
Year.
I don't think he's that bad.
He's garbage.
You can't argue this. The guy is absolute trash.
Dude, he can play. He shows flashes.
No, he can't.
This is an argument for another day. We have lots of questions. Blake Bortles can ball on occasion.
You know what? Tweet at us. Can Blake Bortles play football on
make
occasion?
Make it a poll. Make it a poll.
I will make that a poll. But
I'm
going
to vote yes. Right.
I'm voting no. I will change Twitter accounts to vote no. That's how passionate I am that Blake Bortles is trash.
Blake Bortles
is not terrible.
No, he's not terrible.
He's terrible.
Who would you rather have as your quarterback, Robert Griffin III or Blake Bortles?
Robert Griffin III.
You're lying.
Robert
to yourself.
Griffin III is a better quarterback who can't
You're
stay healthy.
Lying
I'm no, I am 100%. Watch Robert Griffin III.
Do I have to pull up the stats, or are we going to talk about this?
No,
on
I don't want to talk stats because Robert Griffin III is on a terrible team with no receivers. Don't tell me Terrell Pryor is a good receiver. Robert
Terrell
Griffin
Pryor is a good receiver.
Don't tell me he's a great receiver. Don't
he's
tell me
a good
he's
receiver,
on.
Though.
Don't tell me he's on the level of
Hearns.
Robinson and Hearns.
That's fair,
right? Look at. Take out every player on the Cleveland Browns offensive line except for their left tackle. Shout out Joe Thomas. He still hasn't missed a game in like, 12 years?
Yeah, we talked about it on the podcast. Go back and listen
Incredible.
To that podcast.
I read that
article on ESPN. It's a whole thing.
Look at Robert Griffin's first one and a half seasons before he got injured, and tell me that you wouldn't rather have him compared to Blake Bortles.
I don't want to have this conversation right now.
No, I'm going to make this poll.
Make the poll. I don't want
to. I'm going to make this poll. But
we have other shit to talk about.
I want to get to the question first, so then I'll make the poll. And Pete, I'll let you start. At Ryan Gam tweets at us, predict the teams who will be playing in next year's AFC and NFC championship games.
First of all, a lot of involvement from the Bill Cruthers alum. Shout out to Bills, my former high school. AFC and NFC. I mean, can you just say the New England Patriots
who's playing in the championship game though? Give me two teams.
Oh, in the championship.
Yeah, give me two teams.
So two teams. Okay.
Who is playing against the New England Patriots?
Yeah. So if you don't pick the New England Patriots, assuming that Tom Brady and Belichick aren't retiring, you're not.
Well, did you see what Tom Brady said?
Yeah,
about his retirement.
I'm having too much. We saw it in
class.
Yeah,
in our social media class, he said,
"I'm having too much fun." Sorry, babe.
Yeah, he's like, "Sorry, babe. I'm having too much fun. I'm not." His wife wanted to retire.
Tom Brady's like A-Rod at the end of his career. Everyone's like all over it now. No, so I'm gonna go with New England, and I'm gonna say the Oakland Raiders. I really think if Derek Carr comes back and he's healthy, they have enough weapons on offense. I think they're gonna draft a couple guys to shore up the defense. I think that offense is just as good as Atlanta's. Maybe they're slightly lower. But I think the Oakland Raiders could be in that game with the New England Patriots for sure next year.
So real quick, who's your NFC then?
NFC, I really, really want to go out on a limb and say like the Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
Mm.
But I still think they're like another year.
Yeah.
I don't want to go, like, but I really like Jameis Winston.
So give me your two teams then.
If I had to pick right now two NFC teams, is Adrian Peterson going to be healthy the whole year?
Is he even going to be in Minnesota?
I'm going to say, assuming Adrian Peterson's going back to Minnesota and Sam Bradford plays the way he did this year, maybe if they add another, because it's tough to do this without seeing what they do in the offseason.
Yeah.
I'm going to say the Minnesota Vikings as one team because that defense is still really good and they're still got a lot of guys under contract. Chad Greenway retired, who's going to be a bit of a loss for them, but he's also been older, so I feel like they've kind of got the right guys in there to fill in. I'm going to say Minnesota, and I'm going to say, again, like,
you don't
how do you go
say
against
it.
The Atlanta Falcons?
You don't want to say it, but... I think Atlanta might be there. I'm not going to put them in for argument's sake. I'm not going to say them. I agree, New England Patriots. I'm going to make a bold statement and say Denver trades for Tony Romo, and then I put Denver in there. I think Denver edges out
Dallas,
Oakland.
Does Dallas? You know what? I'm going to put Dallas in that game.
You're going to put Dallas?
Year.
So Dallas and
because
Minnesota?
Like we talked about this. I don't know if we talked about it on the show or not. I know I've definitely had conversations with you and with some other people about, you know, if a lot of times in pro sports, usually you got to lose a couple times or at least get that experience of losing in the playoffs before you can really get to that next level. Zeke and Dak, I think Tony Romo does get moved. And if he does go to Denver, I don't want to put them in that game yet only because the guy did not play one snap or played like 10 snaps
and
all year.
And he was on fire.
All right.
So I'm going to put no bias in this. If Denver gets Tony Romo, he brings them to the championship game. I think he is that much of a step up. Now, I still think he loses to Tom Brady, absolutely. My only fear with that is the new head coach and offensive coordinator have both come out and said they like Trevor Siemian and Paxton Lynch. They like the guys they have, which...
John Elway was like John one Elway of the best quarterbacks like of all time.
John
like
Elway likes Paxton Lynch. John Elway likes Paxton Lynch. He doesn't like Trevor Siemian. You can tell.
Paxton Lynch is also got drafted. He's a rookie this year.
He's a year away from being good. I think Tony Romo comes in, mentors him up, and he's good down the road. 2 years away.
Maybe 2 years away.
So I think I'm going to go Tony Romo and leads Denver to play the Patriots. In the NFC, it's kind of a toss-up, and I'm hesitant to say Dallas yet because I think that this flash in the pan might go away. Like Colin Kaepernick, I'm not going to say it's going to go away entirely. I don't think they go 14-2. I think they go 10-6 maybe next year.
I think they're 12-4 for a lock.
They win the division for sure. Hang on, let me finish. They win the division for sure. I don't think they get the first round bye because I'm giving that to Atlanta and Green Bay. And then I'm going to have Atlanta.
Is Green Bay going to have a defense next year?
Doesn't matter because they're going to have their offense back. And give me Green Bay on the same run, but for the whole year, I think Green Bay goes 13-3. Maybe they lose a close one to Atlanta. Maybe they lose a close one to the Giants. Can always upset them. But I'm going Green Bay, Atlanta, and then you have bold prediction: Green Bay, New England next year's Super Bowl market.
If the Giants don't go party in Miami and the receivers don't forget their gloves, we're not even talking about Green Bay.
No, that's true.
So, again, I would love to see. I think Giants, Cowboys, Atlanta, Green Bay are kind of the four teams that I think, like, unless somebody else comes out of nowhere or a team like maybe Seattle revamps a little bit.
Seattle is always dangerous. They're like Chicago in the NHL. Yeah. Like you never know because they might just explode and win 12 straight.
Another team, again, I like the Vikings defense and Adrian Peterson a lot.
I'm not sold on that Vikings defense. They got exposed in the second half of the year.
We'll see. Okay,
next question. First off, make sure you go vote at Big and Tall Sport. Which quarterback would you rather have, Blake Bortles or RG3? Pete, did you vote?
No, I'm going to go vote.
Make sure you go vote because right now, no votes for Blake Bortles. Just putting that out there. Make sure you go vote at Big and Tall Sport. Blake Bortles, RG3, who would you rather have? Next question.
Oh, you voted with the Big and Tall account already?
No, I didn't vote with the Big and Tall account.
You
can't
did.
Vote with the Big and Tall account. I went and changed my account and I voted.
And this is RG3 now. This isn't RG3 when
I still want RG3 now.
You're nuts.
Anyways, we're going to move on. I got another. Let's see. We got a couple of questions. Here we go. So you blow the 28-3 lead. What do you say to your guys after losing the game if you're Atlanta's coach or their owner? This is Alex again.
I think we hit on it a little bit with the Mark Cuban. What is there to say? Like, what can you say? What can you possibly say that's going to make anybody in that room feel
What do you
good?
Try to say? Because you have to say something. You can't go in there and say,
You well, say, hey, at the end of the day, we have the MVP and we played better than this team for 3 out of 4 quarters. And you know what? The experience that you've gotten, like, there's no, I would talk about, like, what the conversation that we just had about the NFC and AFC teams. I would say, listen, we have the MVP sitting over there who played his ass off. We have a ton of weapons on offense who played great. We have a ton of playmakers on defense who are all really young defense, too. Really young defense. And if you're Dan Quinn, you basically say, look, guys, kind of what we just talked about with Dallas. Sometimes you got to lose before you can win. And this was the first time.
You can't go in and say, hey, guys, we got it next year. Because nobody wants to hear that. Because
no,
you had it this year.
You don't want to hear anything, dude. You don't want to hear anything.
But
from no matter what
no,
that guy
the,
says.
The one thing you got to come in and say, guys, I love you.
Yeah.
I love you.
Yes.
Because that at that moment, to know that your coach still has your back and is still there to, that's all he has to do is he has to be there for those players. Before the media gets there, before they have to answer any questions, they have to know, first off, he has to take the blame for this. And maybe not the entire brunt of it, but the coach has to be the guy who comes out and says, I got to take responsibility for this. And then after that, the players can then say, no, it's not his fault, it's ours. Because
100%. I agree with you.
And I think that has to be the message. Guys, I love you. I got your back. you know, and then you can say, let's go get it next year, right? We have to tune our focus. But you got to say to them, guys, like, I love you. We gave it 100%. And I know that I've said I love you a lot, but Pete, I love you, man. I'm just saying it right now. So.
I totally 100% agree. That's definitely what you have to say. You're right.
So, Pete, I want to touch on it. And you, I mean, I know you're excited about this. World Baseball Classic Team Canada roster was just announced. Congrats to Pete. You can mention a few of your friends, actually, guys you've played with.
Yeah.
Just got on there.
So, two guys I played with, Josh Naylor, Daniel Panero. Shout out to the boys. I just texted both of them earlier before we did the show. I talked to Josh about it a couple weeks ago. Obviously, great. You know, we're kind of getting to that age now where, like, you have a bunch of buddies who are playing the CFL now. A bunch of guys who I've played against and with are starting to show up in pro ball and really start establishing themselves. And there were five former Ontario Blue Jays on the roster. And then one guy, Jordan Romano, is playing for Team Italy. It's great. Obviously, a lot of people are talking on Twitter right now about Martin and Saunders. I read an article by Shai Davidi right before we did the... right before we started the show. Shai Davidi said that Martin's not playing because of an insurance issue, because he had a small knee surgery at the beginning of the off season, and I guess there was some sort of insurance policy issue with that. It's not like he didn't want to play or that they didn't want him to play. It's that they didn't want to insure him or they couldn't insure him. And then Michael Saunders just signed a one-year, $9 million contract with the Phillies. So how are you not going to show up for all of camp going into a new team? They're a young team, a rebuilding team. He could have a lot of success there because he's going to play a lot if he stays healthy. So I totally understand why he's not playing as well.
And you kind of touched on it, but any, I guess, notable omissions that, or maybe mentions that maybe guys you thought were in the conversation that are kind of getting forgotten about. I mean, I know it's a pretty big list, and there's only about three guys that have really been mentioned.
The one guy who I was a little surprised that he didn't play, but he's getting older now, so I get it, and he's played in this a couple of times already, is Joey Votto.
Yeah.
He's played every time. This is the fourth WBC. He's played in every one. So I get that he doesn't want to play. I was a little surprised to see guys like Eric Gagne and Ryan Dempster, who haven't pitched in the majors in quite a while, each of them respectively. That should be interesting. Same with Adam Loewen, who was a pitcher, then switched to be a hitter, and then switched back to being a pitcher, which is ridiculous. He was like fourth overall pick, I believe. Highest Canadian ever drafted. So there's some interesting guys on this roster. If you follow Canada baseball, if you have followed Canadian baseball over the last, you know, 5-6 years, there's a lot of familiar faces, guys who played in the Pan Ams and who've played in WBCs in the past. But yeah, the one guy, Joey Votto, but like, again, Freddie Freeman's playing. He's in that notch just below. He's kind of in that. Joey Votto's probably in that top tier first baseman.
He's 1B.
Freddie Freeman's in like. Joey Votto's a top five first baseman. Freddie Freeman's probably a top 10, top 12.
So if you're going Canadian guys, Joey Votto's 1A, Freddie Freeman's 1B.
Yeah.
Is that
like,
fair?
Freddie Freeman's a lot of people, and I think as Atlanta gets better in the next couple of years, people are going to start to talk about Freddie Freeman because the guy's a stud and he's played on a crap team his whole career. But I think that he's, and not a lot of people knew that he was Canadian. Both his parents are from Toronto, his dad's from Toronto, his mom's from Windsor. And they moved to California. His dad moved to California, came back, met his mom. They got married, whatever, moved back to California. He grew up in California. His mom passed away when he was 10 of cancer. And this is kind of like his big homage. He's wanted to play. He wanted to play last time, I believe. But you have Votto and Morneau. What are you going to add?
Long-standing guys,
yeah,
too,
exactly.
Right?
And Morneau is playing again, which kind of surprised me.
Who do you think then you give the nod to game one, early prediction? Who plays first base in game one?
Freddie Freeman plays first base.
For sure?
Yeah.
Okay.
Morneau DH.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah.
It's a mix of a lot of really young guys and really old guys.
Right.
Which is like kind of weird. Like if you look at bad example because they're the US, but their roster is just sick.
Yeah.
Like they have
You say the roster's sick. How realistic of a shot does Canada have in the World Baseball Classic this year? You got about a minute, and we got to wrap it up. But how realistic of a shot do they have You know, maybe give me a percentage.
I'm going to watch all the games, but I'm not expecting very much from them. I mean, they're in a pool where, and that's the thing too, the way that the pools are set up, there's a lot of good teams.
There is.
Like, there's probably five, six, like, okay, Japan, U.S., Dominican, Puerto Rico, Venezuela.
Right.
If any of those teams won, would not surprise me at all. Then you have Cuba, who you don't really know about any of the players because it's the MLB guys aren't allowed to play. And if the MLB guys were allowed to play, that's the team to beat.
Yeah.
And then you kind of have Canada. You have Israel's a bunch it's of MLB like, guys. It's Italy like, is a bunch of like.
It's almost like Canada at the Little League World Series, right? They might make a run at it. They, you know, they might surprise. They might shock a few teams.
They'll be competitive.
They'll be competitive.
Mexico is very good. Like, this is probably the best turnout that they've gotten for this tournament because it might be the last one. There's talks of it being the last one. So, I don't know. We'll see what happens with Canada, but I'm not expecting too much out of them.
Well, best of luck to Canada and to your buddies who are playing in the World Baseball Classic. Should be a great tournament. I mean, I always love international competition. It's always a great time. But we're going to have to wrap it up for this week's episode of the Big and Tall Sports Show. Be sure to check out our interview with Steve Dangle coming out tomorrow on YouTube. And we'll also be posting this episode of the Big and Tall Sports Show on YouTube as well. It's going to wrap it up. For Pete, I'm Alec. Thanks for listening. It's been a great show.